On behalf of the DeVoe family, I want to thank everyone for coming today and welcome everyone. My name is Homer Moore, and I'm an elder in the United Church of God from Garden Grove. I want to point out to you that every one of you that's here today has made the right decision in coming to this particular ceremony. It's not that I'm saying it's the right decision, but your Bibles, the Holy Scripture says it's the right decision. That comes from Ecclesiastes 7. Solomon is saying that it's better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting and partying. For death is the destiny of every one of us, and the living should take this to heart. That's from Scripture. It isn't my idea. I'm passing this along. Verse 3 of chapter 7. Sorrow is better than laughter, because a sad face is good for the heart. What's he talking about? What he's saying is that we learn more from life, we understand more from life, from our trials and our struggles, than we ever do drinking at a party. In verse 4, Solomon says, the heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, and the heart of fools is in the house of pleasure. Today we're here to honor Stanley DeVoe with dignity, honor, with credit, and respect for our good friend Stanley DeVoe. Stanley was an easy person to meet. It was easy to talk to, easy to get to know, very friendly, outgoing. He was an extrovert. He was a people person. He was a people person at heart. And he enjoyed being with people. As you all know, when you're around him, he was upbeat all the time. Because he gave me 100% of his attention. His eyes were focused on me, his thoughts were focused on me, and he wasn't looking around the room at other people. It was just a one-on-one conversation, no matter how many people there were around. That was a beautiful thing about him. I love that about him. He saw the positive side of people always. He always looked at the positive side. This glass of life was always half full. No, it was actually much more than half full. It was completely full and running over. I have to have notes because I don't have a memory left anymore. He also loved God very, very much, and Jesus Christ as well. He loved to teach and talk about God all of the time, not just from the pulpit, but in random conversation. He put God first in his life constantly. That extended beyond his preaching, way beyond that. He loved us all, loved everyone. And he wants us all to be in the first resurrection with him. And he guided and counseled us in that direction. So I'll stand, I'll ask a blessing on family. So final for all of us. Nothing for us immediately after death. We're asking for you to comfort all of the people here today, beginning Mr. DeVoe's family, first of all. Comfort them, help them to understand what's going on here on earth, your earth. Help them not to strike out in anger and frustration. Help them to be kind and gentle. We ask for your mercy, your kindness, your grace, your forgiveness for all of us who need forgiven, who all need forgiven. We ask that for everyone in this room, not just the family, but beginning with the family first. Allow us to show kindness, love, understanding, and patience. Everyone here. Help the family to overcome the sorrow that everyone is feeling. Be with them, allow them comfort, because that's what they need so badly at this time. Losing a personal loved one in your life is never easy. It's a shock for everyone. Please help everyone to understand that. Allow us all to grow in grace and knowledge. Your plan, your purpose, what you're working out here below. Father, thank you for listening. Thank you for acting. Thank you for being there for all of us at this time. In the name of our brother Jesus Christ, we thank you. Family, the most time here on this earth lasted for many years. Some of us are older, some of us are younger. When I was 15 years old, 15 years was young, I had a lot of energy. I looked around at people who were 30 and they were old. 30 years was old. Man, when I was a teenager, I had all this energy. Well, things changed a little bit when I became 30. I was still young. I wasn't old at all. But 50 years old was old because that was a half century. That was a half century, so 50 years was old because men were gray haired, so were women. Not completely, but the start of gray hair was there in a lot of us. But when I got to be 50 years old, I feel all that old. 50 years had gone by, I still felt young. 75 was old then. 75 years, 3/4 of a century. Life was moving on. It was on faster when you get older. Well, when I turned 75 years old, I didn't think that was all that old. 5 years had gone by, I still felt young to some degree. So 100 years old was old. That's a whole full century. If Stanley DeVoe were alive today, I'm sure that he would have the same sentence. Time goes by so fast for all of us, and it accelerates like mad when you get a little bit older. It really moves on. Anna and I were at the Feast of Tabernacles in Oceanside some 3 years ago and heard a friend of ours speaking of a father and son talk that his father had with him. He had the same sentiments. He echoed the same ideas. His dad said, "Son, I'm now 92 years old and life is too short. Life is way too short. Father said, I have a lot of plans yet at 92 years old. There's people that I want to see. I want to see my sons and my daughters. I want to see my grandkids. Got to see them more. There's some trips that I'd like to take, and I got plans for them. I have to roof my house because one of the rooms has a leak in it. The roof. And the house could use another coat of paint. I have more horseshoes to pitch. I can't do anything else other than that. The NFL and the NBA games, there's a lot to watch on television. This year, those Lakers look like the Lakers of old. You know what I mean? I'm sure that Stanley DeBoer would share some of those things because I'm positive he had ideas and plans, but his life ran out. He couldn't finish those ideas. He couldn't finish those plans. That's the same with all of us. Life is too short. Mortal life is too short. Human life is only here for a few years and then it's gone.
Good afternoon. My name is Ruben Rios, and I feel like I'm a protege of Stan DeBoer. Jonathan, his son, is behind me, and my family is here. So I grew up in the Worldwide Church of God, born in 1964, and then moved to the Long Beach Church in about 1986-ish. Well, I met Stan DeBoer. I was a single, and as a single person with an income, you know, we traveled different places. And I went to Spain one year, and then he looks at me through his glasses. He's towering, a little bit taller than I am, and he says, "So Reuben, where are you going to the feast this year?" And I had already looked at the registration form to go to Madagascar. I want to go someplace far away and exotic. And he says, "Well, tell me about that person you met in Spain." So I tell him more. And then he says, "Go to Spain." So, to him, and of course, to the consenting wife, we have five beautiful children, and we are married because of him. He didn't convince me, but he showed me, you know, life is short. You better do what's most important for your life now. So, Amalia, you know, this man, we'll miss him. And I really respected him. And Jonathan may not know all the stories, all the great things that he did as a pastor, but I do have one story that I want to share. You may not have heard it. Stan was a very well-educated, very articulate person, but he didn't have a Californian accent. So you knew right away he was from the South. And despite his intellect and his knowledge, his race or his accent could be a barrier. That's the reality. And I think it was Jeff Kirk who gave him delegated to him to be in charge of the fundraising activities. And every year at the church, we had about 400 people. We would volunteer and we would do the inventory for Macy's. Macy's is a huge department store chain, so we would volunteer. They would close the department stores early. The army of volunteers would go every year, and we would count clothing. We'd be on our knees, down below, putting garments, reaching up shelves, counting clothing, itemizing every inventory of the department store. And Stan, as a former executive, he was with the bigwigs, the department store managers and owners, supervising the teams, taking in the reports. And then that following Saturday, we finished early. That following Saturday, Jeff Kirk announced from the pulpit, "I have a beautiful story, but I want Stan to say it." Do you guys remember that story? I do, because it made a big impact on me. And so Stan DeVoe walked on stage, and he says, "This is what happened. God's people were very meticulous. We're doing the inventory, and we have volunteers. You know, sometimes we stay there past 12 o'clock at night. Former years, remember? Well, we think we had finished around 11:30. And so he tells the manager in charge of the department store, "You know, my people here, you know, they're working real hard, very gently. They've, you know, finished early. So we were only getting paid per the hour, I think." So he negotiated very adroitly and very persuasively. They gave us like a $5,000 bonus for finishing early, because they were still going to make the same amount of money or more, because they wouldn't have to, they could close the store earlier, they could pay their employees less by having them go earlier. So that was like, that's my man. That is Stan DeVoe. He's got that gift of negotiation, of leadership, of, you know, thinking ahead. The other story I want to share is that when we came back from Spain, we were still dating, not married. Amalia says, "You should get something for Mr. DeVoe, because I always talk about Stan DeVoe, Stan DeVoe." So we bought a kitchen clock, and we brought it back, and we gave it to Jean Marie and to Stan. And every time I would see Stan, your dad, he would say, "Reuben, we still have that clock, the ceramic clock in our kitchen. It's still working. It's still there." But I can say that your dad is very proud of you. You have his business entrepreneur genes. You have your mom's love and gift of being a people person. He's very proud of you. We're very proud of you, Jonathan. And don't ever think that you did enough to let your dad know how much you loved him, because we know that you're busy. He's busy, even though the distance is far away. He knew that you would be successful, and you are successful.
Yeah, 1968, Stan DeVoe, after he was graduated, was sent out to assist me and to be trained in the ministry. And we were stationed in Mobile, Alabama. We worked the whole southeast, from Florida, Atlanta, Georgia, Mississippi, Alabama, a little bit of Tennessee. Our responsibility was to keep the blacks, natives, on the reservation, because the whole country was in turmoil at that time because of the black progressive movement. So our job was to go down, since we grew up in the South, and relate to our black members as elders and keep them in the church. Now, initially, we were not segregating in the church, but because of the problems with the riots and the burnings and all of that, it was decided to train some of the black elders in the church and blacks who were in positions of leadership, so they could go out and relieve the white ministers who would have problems possibly serving the black brethren. So Stan DeVoe was sent out, I think, in 1968 to assist me in Mobile, Alabama. And amazing guy that he was, I learned about as much from him because of his background and his experience, because he grew up in the South as well. And I'd like to say some of the interesting things about our relationship. We'd go out visiting the members, and because of his love and experience working with people, he'd lean right in and just draw them in. And in most of the churches where we visited, since I was already ordained as an elder, I would end up speaking. And the people we had visited and the people who didn't know us that well, who were members of the church, were surprised that Stan wasn't the one giving the sermonette. That's the kind of impact he had on people. He would just lovingly lean right into you and talk with you. So I learned about as much from him as he learned from me. And I dubbed him Stan the Man, because I grew up in the South as well. And I remember one of the pastors, I won't tell which church area it was, when he knew we were coming, he phoned me and says, "Well, now I have racist neighbors, so you guys will have to come into the bank, into the back door." So I told Stan that, we're going to have to go into the back door. Stan says, "This is a new day. This is a new time. I'm not going in anybody the back door." I said, "I'm with you, Stan." And I'll tell one more story. When Grace was sick, I was here in California at the time, and I spent a lot of time with her during her long illness. And one night, the two witnesses came over to heal her. Two black witnesses came over to heal her. And I was just as surprised as Stan was. But his patience and his love and his concern, he listened to their story, and he says, "Aren't you all supposed to be performing all kinds of miracles?" "Yeah, but that will come later, but we're here to heal your wife." He says, "Well, I don't believe you're the two witnesses. And if you are, you'll understand where I'm coming from, because I see no evidence that you are, so I'm going to have to ask you to leave." So that's the kind of person he was. He humble in many ways, but very assertive, and very knowledgeable, and very loving. So I was assigned to train him as he came up in the ministry. And I learned as much from him, I'm sure, as he learned from me. And we were lifetime friends, over 51-year relationship. He came all the way from New York to marry me and my wife. So I just returned from his memorial service there. And we had a tremendous crowd there, about three times the number here. He is the only minister I know in our denomination who was laid off twice and rehired in the ministry. So that's the kind of witness he was and the kind of usage that God got out of him.
Leslie Schmidis, Darlene, Keith Kent, and all those others. My mother would have loved to have been here. I took her through a hard week. It was a little bit hard for her. But I'm here to represent that. And in a minute, I'm going to talk to Jonathan. But in the meantime, I'm going to tell a story, my Stan DeVoe story. We were at the Feast of Tabernacles in Italy. And actually, this is Aretha Green's story to tell, but she didn't come today, so I'm going to tell it because we just reminisced on it the other day, that he was dancing with her. And love your dad and everything, Stan, Jonathan, but he wasn't finding the right beat, particularly on that song. But we were in Italy, so get that part. We were in Italy, so that makes a difference. So Aretha was asking him, she said, "Mr. DeVoe, what time are you on?" And he was trying to look at his watch because he thought she was talking about time zone or whatever. But it was like he was not on the beat she was looking for. So that was my little, I want to bring some levity here and tell that one story about him. But for you, Jonathan, in particular, what I wanted to say is that having had that lifestyle, right, growing up a PK, as I did as well, I hope that in this moment when you hear from people and you see the things or feel the things or the impact your dad's had on other lives, it makes it a little easier to handle the sacrifices you had as a child because of what he did for his work, because those were sacrifices, and I know them.
There was no sniffing and snuffing. He was show nothing. Stan had the ability to coerce players into making silly mistakes. I don't know how he learned that, but I'd sit back and take a couple of notes and figure out what he was doing, but he's still with me. But we had a lot of fun as families interacting together. I remember Jonathan took my daughter to homecoming, to prom, something like that. Back in the day, they were. And then my older daughter and he went to Long Beach State together for a couple of years. And I was a referee in YOU, that's Youth Opportunities United, when Jonathan was running track. That boy was fast and cut. So I just want to let you know that there are memories that will always be with us, fond memories of the entire family. I just wanted to share a few with you.
I just want to say that growing up in WCG, it was a pretty strict upbringing. And for me, with Stan and Grace, I had never known pastors that could come to your house and play bed with and have fun, just laugh and joke and have a great time. You know, usually when the minister come in, everybody had to, you know, act a certain way and whatever. But they were so personable that people loved them so much. We could literally just party. Lewis and I used to give a lot of parties when we were very young up in Altadena. And they would always come. And then they would invite us down when they were pastoring in Long Beach. They would have us at their house and stuff, and we'd play big with. But they were so personable for ministry. And it was something so different than what I would have expected from pastors in our church. He was very special. Grace was even more special to me. We became really close, shared a lot of girl stuff, and just want to say, Jonathan, you had great parents. They were just great. I know that God had a smile on his face all the time for the representation that they gave him.
I quit attending as a teenager, went out and was going to become a rock star and all that, and that didn't happen. Yeah, I had real long hair, and I remember it finally, I had to come back. You know, my mom was such a good example, and I came back, and I remember sitting out, I'll never forget the first time I came back, actually, over at Worldwide in Long Beach, and everyone was in their nice suit, short hair, shoes shined, and I'm thinking, I'm in the wrong place. You know, this isn't happening. And Mr. DeVoe was the guy that came up to me and really
he took me in. And I felt so comfortable. He was such an amazing man. And Mr. Dietrich, I owe you a lot of gratitude too, because you were there. You know the heart. I got to tell a funny story, though. So I'm back at church. Things are going good. I got my suit. I got my hair cut off. Mr. Kirk, one time, he would, you know, it's funny because my hair is like down here. Mr. Kirk, I'll never forget one time he walks to the back and goes, maybe you got to think about getting that haircut, Gary. Okay, it's that time. So I started attending some of the functions and stuff, and there was a dance, some kind of a dance. And some girl had locked her keys in her car, and I was going to be the nice guy, right? I'm out there, and we got a coat hanger, and I'm like knee-deep and trying to get her into her car. And Mr. DeVoe comes walking up, and he's sort of laughing, and he's going, oh, guys. And he said something to the fact of, well, I know what you do on your spare time. And I never forgot that. Jonathan, your dad, I never really got to know your mom, but your dad was awesome, man. Oh, another thing, too, the day has changed because my dad passed away back in 1989, and my mom asked him to do the services. And he did, and he didn't have any qualm about it. And there was like 300 white people in this church building, and there comes Stan DeVoe, and the whole crowd was like, this guy's awesome. You know, color was not a thing to him, and he was just, he respected everyone like he wanted to be respected and treated, and he was an awesome man.
Oh, man, I don't know what to do with him, but It was very intimidating to look at him when you first saw him. And, but he was just the opposite when you got to know him. He seemed like an educated man. I didn't know him, but he just seemed, you didn't know what to say, but he would make you feel at ease. Because it was as if he knew that's how you felt. And for some reason, we remember things a lot of times that are not important, but there are things we remember. For some reason, more than anything, I remember how pretty his wife was.
Great Gomes, Bellflower. I just want to say one thing about Mr. Davies brought up the YOU. It was where our teenagers were involved in sports. And you made me think about a track meet, and they had an invitational for the men 40 and over, and I missed it before we entered it, but there was another kid whose dad was a track man. And, you know, people were thinking he was going to win, but that guy stumbled and fell, and Mr. DeVoe dusted the rest of the field. So the next Sabbath, I was talking to him at the back of the church. A lot of us go back there and talk. And all, you know, everybody's talking. And I said, hey, you know what? When you won that race, I said, I looked over at your son. He was so happy that you won. You know, I guess that you weren't expecting because that track man was there. But he did win. And he, when I told him his son was so happy, he told me, thanks, man. Thank you. Well, I really love Grace's mom, nice lady, and Mr. DeVoe, great guy.
Once again, I want to thank the DeVoe family, thank Jonathan, and I also want to thank Terrell Brown, because I did not know about this situation until actually today. He was someone that told me there was a memorial. And I met Mr. DeVoe back in, I think it was 1980 in New York. And I did not know him as personally, but sometimes you know about a person by the person that they are with, that is, those that are close to them. I did not know his first wife. She must have been a tremendous woman. But I did know his second wife. And what I wanted to share was that his second wife, Jean Marie Warden, I had known as a single person. That was a long time ago, of course. And what struck me is that this particular single person that I knew, and there were single people in the Roy Church crowd, of course, was always talking about getting married. You know, that was just the thing. And not just that, but getting married to a person that really loved the Lord, someone who loved Christ. And she was concerned about the fact that she was getting older and, you know, things were not looking so well. And we would talk about that kind of thing. And then she came in contact with Stan DeVoe. And they developed a friendship that obviously developed into a relationship and marriage. But I remember that because I knew the kind of person that she was. I knew the kind of person that she wanted to be with. And she was willing to wait. And sometimes it doesn't happen for everyone. But when she found him, it was clear that God had brought her into her life. The other thing I wanted to mention, I just wanted to really, I appreciate the music that was given, Take Me to the King. And the reason for that is, actually my wife had just died about a year ago. And she chose that specific song as well, which I really appreciate. I realized that the other thing that I wanted to say was this. When I started attending the Church of God, it was a very difficult time for me because I didn't grow up in the church. I came into it. And one of the things that I lost out on at that period was my interaction that I had with my father. And there seems to be a trend or a stream of certain men that have come up in our community, particularly from the South, who endured so much difficulty, and yet never talked about that. They just went about their business, they projected the best things that could possibly be projected about black men. And I really appreciated that about Mr. DeVoe and those men that pretty much paved the way, not simply because they were black, but because they had a love for the Lord. So I can see that with your father, and I can see that in you as well, even though I don't know that as much. So I just want to thank you once again and appreciate the opportunity we have to share this year. Thank you.
I just wanted to say, Jonathan, thank you so much for having this today for us so that we all could get together and remember your dad. Your hospitality today is greatly appreciated. And I just thought in regards to the hospitality, when we met your dad out here in California, we didn't really get to know him that well, but when we planned the trip back to New York, we got in contact with him, and he said that we could stay with him while we were there. So he treated us like royalty that whole time. I think we were there 2 or 3 nights. And on one day, he took the whole day off from work and showed us New York. And that was the most, one of the most memorable events of our life, because I don't know how much of New York we didn't see. And he explained stuff so well to us, so we felt like, man, we now almost New Yorkers. But at any rate, that was truly special. And I just wanted you to know that a lot of his traits, obviously, he passed on to you. And you've developed them. And just thank you again so much for this opportunity.
Jason Luther, as I mentioned before, I attended the funeral up there in New York. She had a lot of loose ends to tie up. But I think they're recording the comments this evening, this afternoon, and she will probably hear the love and admiration that all of you had for him. And what a tremendous example of humility and love and caring he was. And it was a blessing that we got to know him. They only had one child, and I remember, Jonathan, they only had one child, and I remember we would leave Mondays, Tuesdays. Monday was our office day, so we only had Sundays off. Sabbath, we attended church. We had Sundays off, and Mondays was our office day to do all of our bookkeeping and sending all our visits and all of this thing. And Tuesday we went on the road. So he was not with his wife. So they ended up with one child.
Yeah.
Shut up, I'll talk too much. We were very close. We were very close. And as the scripture says there, some people we meet were closer than brothers. And I feel that we were standing. He came all the way from New York on his own dime when I married. And I had no excuse for my wife and I to go up for this memorial service. We were there, I think, for his 52nd anniversary. So just a great contribution to the Church of God. And we're going to miss him, and we know that he's going to get a great rule.
In 1968, and so I was there when Stan came and ended up being the associate pastor with Jud Kirk. I believe it was in the late 80s, into the 90s. And so I got to know him quite well, and there's hardly anything else to say because y'all have already said it, you know, but everything that you've said is exactly the way I feel. You know, he was such a warm, loving, easy to talk with person. He was a strong character, but still he, on the other hand, could be a regular guy. And you didn't feel like you had a bomb and scrape to him because he had his minister's cap on. You could just talk to him as a friend. And that was the kind of relationship I had with him. Always felt very, very comfortable around him. And we were brothers in the Lord, you know.
My mother had pictures of me crawling on their floor, and she like labeled it at the tapes. So when she said her name, I remember the pictures that I saw growing up. I wrote in the program a little tribute, so I hope you read it. But I won't bother you to read it out loud. Just share a few things about my father. I think he was a minister full-time in the church in the early 70s, late 60s with Mr. Brown. My father loved being in the Worldwide Church of God. Just the whole, the membership, the fellowship, and the passing into the headquarters. I remember him always telling me, there's nothing like, you know, that's all I ever knew, being in the church. That's all I grew up in the church. So you kind of take it for granted because you don't know anything else. He's like, man, and he's always telling me, you don't know how good you have it. We just have the best people. And you know, we felt that, you know, we really felt that we were called to be in the Worldwide, all of us that were there. And obviously, I don't know how many years it's been now, Worldwide seemed like it's kind of splintered off a little bit. But I just have those memories of Worldwide and going to the Feast of Tabernacles and everybody just being together. And being a PK was a little bit tough. But I just remember being happy to be in the church. You know, obviously there were some rules. No Friday night parties. You know, obviously none of us could celebrate Christmas and all that. But I remember didn't miss Christmas too much because we had the Feast of Tabernacles. And I think that for my family, for us, that was kind of, I don't know, quote unquote, our Christmas. I think I would get feast gifts. And so I used to like gifts. And so at the feast, we would get gifts and we would, you know, go different places. Went to, you know, overseas some. Sometimes we would go in the States. And so that's, you know, the memories I have of my father. Obviously, we had our own father-son memories, but a lot of my memories are just family memories with the church and just all of you. Because I was like a real integral part of his life. You know, the one thing I admire about my father, I never hear him say anything negative about anything or anyone. And what I value is I've never really heard anyone say anything negative about him. It's always just been positive. And even though he loved being a minister, I used to ask him, why don't you want to be a private practice, private industry, you can make more money. And, you know, he didn't really care about the money.
When I die, will I live again? Job 14:14 asks that question and answers it. Job is saying, if a man dies, will he live again? All the days of my hard service, I will wait until my renewal, meaning my resurrection, comes. You will call and I will answer you. You will long for the creature your hands have made. Surely then, you will count my steps, but not keep track of my sin. My offenses will be sealed up in a bag, and you will cover over my sins. Job 19, verse 25, Job continues with the same theme. See, Job knew that he would live again. Mr. DuBois knew it as well, because he talked about these scriptures. Job 19 and verse 25. I know that my Redeemer is living, and that in the end he will stand upon this earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. Oh, how my heart yearns within me. That's a lot of hope and a lot of encouragement for Job, and it continues as well in the New Testament.
Paul told me a story about him hitchhiking when he was a young man. He's hitchhiking in the South, and he said he finally got a ride. He said, this is this old beat-up pickup truck. These two guys stopped and gave him a ride, and he said there was two white men. They had me get in the middle. One guy on this side, and there's one guy on that side, and he said, I'm here in the middle, and I'm thinking, what am I doing here? And he said, I began to get nervous with these guys. We kept on talking and talking. It didn't take long for me to get to my destination, and he said, absolutely nothing happened. He said, it was beautiful. It was beautiful. He said, God protected me all the way. And he said, I was worried for nothing. And the second thing I want to share with you, with everyone here, with you all, Stanley DeVoe was kind enough 27 years ago to marry Anna and I. 27 years ago. Okay, we're going to have a song, Dance with My Father. Dance with My Father.
My father.